Dear colleagues, welcome to this part of the course. In this chapter, we can finally address a feature which is in contrast to all other ultrasound characteristics has a biological standard. Extrathyroid extension is a controversial topic. While this is the only feature which can be compared to a biological standard, the usefulness is substantially hindered by several circumstances. First, we should bear in mind the normal anatomy of the thyroid, the lack of a complete fibrous capsule surrounding the organ. The second issue is that in contrast with most malignant conditions of the human body, the extrathyroidal spread does not mean itself a worse prognosis in all forms. The third issue is the far from ideal sensitivity of ultrasound in detection of extrathyroidal growth. Considering the limitations of the ultrasound in the judgment of extrathyroidal spread, we need to treat with very strong caution that the extrathyroidal spread observed on ultrasound affects staging and treatment according to the newest TNM system. To put it mildly, there is a contradiction between the possible role played or dedicated to in TNM classification system and the real diagnostic power of ultrasound in extrathyroidal spread. In the first part of the lecture, we shortly discuss the newest TNM classification system because the most important change in the latest 8th edition affects the handling of extrathyroidal spread. Thereafter, we present the potential and limitations of ultrasound in the judgment of extrathyroidal spread. We demonstrate the role of this property in various thyroid systems and in the most frequent subtypes of thyroid cancers. One of the most important changes in the 8th edition of TNM staging is the removal of the minor extrathyroidal extension from the definition of T3 disease in the event of differentiated thyroid cancer if extrathyroidal growth was detected only on histological examination. This led to downstaging a significant number of patients from stage 3 to either stage 1 or stage 2 disease. Minor extrathyroidal extension does influence neither the category nor the staging of the tumor. Perhaps it is not an exaggeration to even call the new TNM schedule paradigmatic, given that up to 70% of the most common thyroid cancers have been given a different staging compared with the former TNM classification. The second one is a very important consideration, and clinicians should be aware that gross extrathyroidal spread is handled in a pathological staging system, not as a pathological, but as a clinical finding. We have three tools on which a gross extrathyroidal spread can be diagnosed. We have three tools on which a gross extrathyroidal spread can be diagnosed. These are the preoperative radiological findings, the intraoperative surgical findings, and the postoperative macroscopic evaluation of the specimen. Be aware that microscopic analysis has no role in the judgment because the role of microscopy is limited to minimal extension, which has absolutely no influence on staging. According to the TNM rulebook, radiological findings have to be integrated in the pathological workflow. The final consequence remained unchanged. Extrathyroidal extension has a deep impact on further therapy of patients. Let me emphasize an unusual circumstance once more. Microscopic analysis has virtually no role in determining extrathyroidal extension. This is because the degree of it visible only with the microscope no longer affects the clinical stage, and among factors which influence the staging, microscopic analysis has no role. Let's see the main table of the TNM staging. First, let me ask you to focus on the left column. The basic distinction is the minor and the gross extrathyroidal extension. The latter has 3 degrees according to the anatomical structure invaded. As we go down in the first column, the degree of extrathyroidal spread increases. The microscopic analysis has role only in the finding of minimal extension. Here, to the point of a finding, I run forward. This is very important for us. Minimal extraterrestrial spread is what ultrasound is best for. Essentially, ultrasound is suitable for which its clinical and prognostic significance has ceased to exist. Following with the third column, we can see that minimal extension has no role in the TNM status, while depending on the extent of gross spread, the tumor belongs either to T3 or T4 category. Another important change in the new system is that the age limit has been elevated from 45 to 55 years. Let's see the fourth column. Under the age of 55, all cases belong to stage 1 clinical group, except for patients with distant metastasis. So, in younger patients, extraterrestrial spread has no role in the clinical staging. It means that, for example, a younger patient with a papillary cancer that breaks into the trachea has an average chance of 98 to 100% for a 10-year disease-free survival. In contrast with younger patients, the pathological TNM staging has deep impact on clinical staging in older patients. As I have emphasized, according to the TNM system, radiology is one of the three means by which gross extraterrestrial extension can be demonstrated. In contrast with surgical exploration and the gross pathological examination, which rely on the reality, radiological examination requires interpretation of images and videos. In other words, while two tools depend mainly on the thorough analysis of a visible and palpable specimen by the surgeon and the pathologist, as I will demonstrate, there is a deep concern about the radiology as a tool on which the further management of a patient may be based on. What is the cause for the concern about this suggestion? This table shows the main statistical parameters of the ultrasound and MRI regarding their performance in detection or exclusion of extraterrestrial spread. I focus on the probably most important one, on the positive predictive value. If radiology were indeed suitable for judging extraterrestrial propagation, this value would have to be very high. This value is very good in the judgment of minimal extraterrestrial extension. However, as we have already learned, minimal spread has no relevance in the further staging and therapy of patients. In terms of gross extension, positive predictive value is much worse at only 50%. This value means that neither ultrasound nor MRI is accurate enough to be the basis of a decision that affects a patient's fate. If relied on these radiological findings, more than half of the patients were upgraded regarding the clinical or pathological status. This table shows the performance of the two methods in judging the infiltration of major anatomical structures. The positive predictive values range from 14 to 62, which means that neither ultrasound nor MRI is able to judge the degree of gross extension. As the data prove, the role of radiology is the exclusion of extraterrestrial spread, and in this area the results are excellent. The study of Kim and co-workers is not an exception, but the rule. Other studies had a similar conclusion. The ultrasound assessment of the extraterrestrial extension shows a wide range of diagnostic sensitivities, specificities, and accuracy values for the diagnosis of the extraterrestrial growth. What about the third preoperative modality, the computer tomography? In a series of almost 300 consecutively registered patients with pathologically proven papillary thyroid cancer who underwent preoperative computer tomography and ultrasound, ultrasound was more accurate than CT in predicting extraterrestrial tumor extension and multifocal bilobar disease. The accuracy of staging was better overall with ultrasound, and ultrasound had greater sensitivity than CT at predicting lateral compartment metastasis. It means that the concern Affecting ultrasound and MRI as a basis for a postoperative pathological staging is also present in the event of computer tomography. The diagnostic performance of CT is similar in the judgment of extratidal spread. The positive predictive value is again around 50%. So what lessons can be learned from these data? The newest TNM classification assumes that radiology is suitable for judging not only the existence of a spread, but also the extent of the extension. In fact, none of the preoperative radiological methods are suitable to influence the postoperative treatment or prognosis of the patients. It is obvious that we can rely on radiological examination regarding neither the presence nor the extent of gross extratidal spread. In my opinion, current protocols, target systems and algorithms have serious responsibility to deceive pathologists. The clear wording required in the radiological report is not backed by professional and scientific evidence. While there is no room for uncertainty in the medical report, in most cases we only guess that a certain characteristic is present, and this is particularly true for extratidal spread. Naturally, experienced teams are aware of the several limitations of ultrasound and other radiological modalities in the judgment of extratidal spread, but this uncertainty is absolutely lacking in the wording of guidelines. The gravity of the problem is shown by the fact that such a world-renowned publication, the TNM classification, is to say the least, is misleading. While radiological examinations and ultrasound has no systematic role in the detection of extratidal spread, these tools have a great potential in the event of extratidal extension. This potential is not the justification, but the exclusion. We move on to the second part of the lecture. We discuss the real role of ultrasound in extratidal spread. We present the ultrasound signs which might suggest extension, demonstrate the limitations and potential. We analyze the role of extratidal spread in the various thyroids and in the different subtypes of thyroid cancers. First, a very important consideration. We must realize that ultrasound signs of extratidal growth is used in two different senses. First, these signs may suggest extratidal spread. Second, these signs are useful to predict the cancer irrespectively of spreading extratidal or not. In the latter sense, these signs are similar to microcalcification, irregular border or shape, and deep hypercalcogenicity. Guidelines differ as to which goal of these signs are used for. In the presentation, we have so far examined the fulfillment of the first goal of whether ultrasound is suitable for predicting extratidal growth. So, what are the ultrasound signs of a possible extratidal extension? Basically, we can examine two phenomena, the integrity of the thyroid capsule and the contour of the nodule. There are three possibilities regarding the capsule. It can be continuous, discontinuous, or invisible. Three types of contour exist. This can be covered by normal parenchyma. If not covered by thyroid tissue, then contour can be abutting and bulging. Perhaps the most important consideration relies on nodules which are covered by normal parenchyma. In such cases, the likelihood of extratidal spread is practically zero. The possibility of extratidal growth can be considered if the capsule is discontinuous or invisible and the contour is abutting or bulging. These are the possible ultrasound signs of extratidal extension. Let's see first the thyroid capsule. Unfortunately, the thyroid does not have a real capsule, only a pseudocapsule. The outer layer of this pseudocapsule does not cover the entire thyroid gland, it only connects the thyroid to other organs of the neck. Consequently, a discontinuous pseudocapsule is a normal finding. Extratidal spread can be raised if the capsule is discontinuous and the contour is abutting. the discontinuation has no relevance if the nodule is covered by normal tissue. In this case, the capsule, an echogenic line, is pointed with red arrows. This capsule is discontinuous between red arrowheads. It means that in those parts of the nodule where it is in contact with the surface of the lobe, in other words, the contour is abutting. As in great proportion of cases, a deeply hypoechoic nodule is the lesion in question, and in these cases, the echogenicity of the nodule is identical to that of the strap muscle. See yellow arrows. The second feature which might suggest exotidal spread is the abutment. Abutment means that the nodule is adjacent to the thyroid capsule and is not covered by normal parenchyma. The issue is that a nodule located at the edge of the thyroid is a very common phenomenon. Therefore, we speak about abutment if it exceeds a certain value. The perimeter of abutting part of the nodule has to be compared to the perimeter of the entire nodule. There is no universally accepted degree of abutment which should be held as pathological. It seems self-evident that higher the ratio of perimeter contacts with the adjacent capsule, higher the likelihood of exotidal extension. The overall accuracy of abutment is far from ideal. Previously, we demonstrated that the positive predictive value is around 50%. The issue is that great proportion of non-spreading cancers and benign lesions are adjacent to the capsule of the thyroid. On the other hand, the lack of abutment has a huge negative predictive value. These images present how to calculate the extent of abutment. The two endpoints of the abutting part of the ventral wall of the nodule are marked with white arrowheads. We have to relate the perimeter, in other words the arc of the nodule which is in contact with the nodule surface, to the perimeter of the entire lesion. There is another method to calculate this ratio. To compare the diameters of the abutting part of the nodule with the largest parallel diameter of the lesion seems to be easier to calculate. It means that we can relate the distance between arrowheads to the distance between arrows. Following the rule of geometry, the half of this ratio corresponds to the ratio of perimeters. Taking the diameters instead perimeters into account has an advantage in lesions which present abutment in oblique sections. This is illustrated by the right images. The abutting perimeter ratio is lower than 10% in this nodule, while the half of the diameter quotient is between 25 and 50%. The angle should be taken into account in such nodules. It means that parallel diameters should be measured. Bulging is a special form of abutment. Bulging contour means that the nodule protrudes into anatomical structures outside the thyroid. Naturally, this is a more serious sign. However, even benign nodules might present bulging. We present here two examples. Both papillary carcinomas presented bulging contours. The red arrows in the right case point to intact parts of the thyroid capsule, while yellow arrows do to the most protruding, to the most bulging part of the tumor. This table summarizes the possible combinations of ultrasound presentations of capsule and contour with the related risk of extratidal extension. We should consider the risk of extratidal growth if the capsule is discontinuous and the nodule presents at least abutting contour. If such nodule does not show bulging, then the risk of gross extratidal growth is low, while if it bulges, then gross extension cannot be excluded. So there is a real risk of gross extratidal spread if the nodule presents all three signs of a potential extratidal growth. Both nodules present abutting and bulging contours. The yellow arrows point to the most dorsal and the most ventral part of the non-nodular tissue, left and right cases respectively. Or in other words, yellow arrows show the point where the nodules start protruding. The difference between the cases relies on the presentation of the capsule. In the left benign nodule, the capsule marked with red arrows is continuous, while in the right malignant case, the capsule is discontinuous. The next theme should be the most voluminous part of the topic. In advance, this won't be. So the question relies on the diagnostic value of ultrasound in the prediction of thyroid cancer. I repeat myself. In the first part of the lecture, it became evident that ultrasound is an unsuitable tool to play any role in determining the patient's final TNM staging. The problem was that the TNM classification assigned a role to ultrasound regarding extratidal extension for which it was not suitable. This is not to say that extratidal extension should not play a major role in ultrasound diagnostics of cancer irrespectively of extratidal spread. And indeed, the extratidal growth, similarly to other suspicious characteristics, should be a very important feature on which we can rely. Similarly to other suspicious characteristics, extratidal extension should have its limitations. So, let's see a summary of the findings published in the literature. Sorry for the technical problem, I am on to fix it. Oh no, this blank paper is caused not by technical reasons, but reflects the real situation, the lack of studies. It is strange, because the three American thyroid systems mention extratidal spread among suspicious findings regarding the detection of cancer. However, in contrast with all other suspicious features, in the event of extratidal extension, studies focus exclusively on the diagnostic power of ultrasound for the judgment of extratidal extension, but not on the diagnostic performance of ultrasound for the detection of malignancy. I found only one single publication. The work of Yun and co-workers have found that ultrasound signs of extratidal growth are at least as useful as other suspicious features in the ultrasound risk stratification for medullary thyroid cancer. We present the data of a recent yet unpublished work. Our results confirm that the diagnostic performance of ultrasound signs of extratidal growth is similar to that of other four suspicious ultrasound characteristics in diagnosing or predicting thyroid cancer. Moreover, the ultrasound signs of extratidal growth emerges from the features regarding its high specificity and positive predictive value. I emphasize here again that these data rely not on the recognition of extratidal spread, but on the recognition of thyroid cancers. In this table, ultrasound signs of extratidal extension were tested against the two different goals, predicting extratidal spread and predicting thyroid cancers. I do not want to read the table, you can pause the video to immerse in detail. I just drew attention to a strange thing. The positive predictive value of ultrasound signs of extratidal extension are significantly better for the detection of cancer than for the detection of gross extratidal extension itself. If we compared the intra-observer variations, extratidal growth proved to be the second best among features analyzed and the best among suspicious characteristics. The strength of agreement was very good. But what does this very good statistical result mean? This good agreement meant that there was an almost five-fold difference between the investigator who found the most frequent and least frequent extratidal extension. Let me remember you that the investigators were highly experienced experts of thyroid ultrasound. So, to summarize this theme, ultrasound signs of extratidal spread have a similar value to other features in predicting malignancy. Now we move to the next topic, to the occurrence of extratidal spread in the most frequent subtypes of thyroid cancer. This huge American database included more than 240,000 surgically treated patients. The occurrence of extratidal spread was lower than in most papers published in the literature. This might be explained by the difference in skills of an average and of a highly experienced evaluation group. Nonetheless, the table demonstrates the real situation and is suitable to compare the extratidal spread in different subtypes of thyroid cancers. So more than 10% of papillary and medullary thyroid cancers presented with extratidal spread, while this figure was much lower in the event of follicular cancer. Regarding ROS extension, papillary cancers account for 4% and medullary cancers for 5%. These ratios are frequently much higher in clinical studies. The incidence of extratidal spread in well-differentiated thyroid cancer varies in different series but ranges from 5% to 34%. Essentially, minimal extratidal extension is present in every 6th to every 4th of papillary and medullary cancers, but the risk of gross extension is around 5% in these cancers. These values are much lower in the event of follicular cancer. So, similarly to other suspicious ultrasound characteristics, extratidal extension is more frequent in papillary and medullary cancer than in follicular tumors. In contrast with the previous more indolent tumors, one of the most important clinical features of the anaplastic cancer is the direct spread. It is the exception when this very aggressive tumor does not invade neck structures. Turning to the last topic, we will analyze the role of extratidal spread in 5 classification systems. This table summarizes the most important considerations. Basically, 3 thyroids involve extratidal extension in the categorization of thyroid nodules. Be aware that in contrast with the other systems, the AACE guideline uses only 3 categories. So in the AACE classification system, the presence of extratidal growth automatically puts the lesion into the most suspicious category. In the system of the American Clinical Radiologist, extratidal growth is worth to 3 points, which following the logic of the system means that the lesion belongs either to the most or the most suspicious but one subgroup. In the thyroids of the American Thyroid Association, extratidal extension classifies a nodule as most suspicious if it is hypoechoic, while isoechoic lesions cannot be categorized if they show suspicious signs including extratidal extension. In contrast with the former systems, neither the thyroids of the current Society of Radiologists nor that of the European Thyroid Association takes extratidal extension into account in generating a score, mainly because the ultrasound-based diagnostic criteria for extratidal growth is somewhat subjective and has not been established yet. The handling of extratidal growth might cause some confusions by using the current thyroids. On the one hand, the system does not involve this feature into generating the score and therefore indication of finding the respiration cytology based on the score and the size of the nodule. On the other hand, the current guideline takes the extratidal growth more seriously because it suggests FNA even in the suspicion of extratidal growth. Moreover, in contrast with all other suspicious features, irrespectively of nodule size. The European Thyroid Association thyroid classification system is although more consistent, but seems to be less realistic. This system describes the presentation of extratidal growth, but does not suggest FNA in the event of extratidal extension. These were the rules of the thyroids. Let's see how they deal with the problems discussed earlier. It has the less than 50% predictive value of ultrasound and the uncertainty regarding the ultrasound features. The European guidelines describe the 3 basic ultrasound features on which extratidal spread can be considered, but as we have mentioned, ETA does not involve extratidal extension in the thyroid score. The approach of the current thyroids has been also mentioned. The wording of the AACE seems to be curious. AAC repeatedly uses the form evidence of extratidal growth, however, fails to present the specific signs of the evidence. If you follow this presentation, you will not wonder. If we lack something in the field of ultrasound and extratidal extension, this is the evidence. For the sake of truth, it must be said that AACE is firmly worded at one single point. I quote, due to the non-negligible prevalence of extracapsular extension in subcentimetric tumors, suspicious high-risk lesions less than 10 mm should receive FNA for early diagnosis and treatment when subcapsular, especially if associated with capsular abutment. This is a very important consideration because in general, AECA does not indicate FNA in lesions less than 1 cm in diameter, even if they present suspicious findings. Similarly to AACE, the American Thyroid Association also uses the phrase evidence of extrathyroidal growth and again, similarly to AACE, fails to describe what does it mean. In my opinion, the approach of the American College of Radiologists is the most useful and forward-looking regarding extrathyroidal spread. This guideline describes the basic concepts about extrathyroidal extension and very realistically suggests taking extrathyroidal growth into account only in obvious cases, which are characterized by frank invasion of adjacent soft tissue and/or vascular structures. What can be the take-home messages? Recent TNM classification includes preoperative radiological findings, those of ultrasound as well, among those means on which the TNM and clinical status should be determined. Unfortunately, the scientific data does not back the assumption that preoperative radiology may have any decisive role in postoperative staging. In my opinion, this is a serious failure that we could use preoperatively suspected extrathyroidal growth for postoperative staging. Nonetheless, we must be aware about the rules and we have to take into account that our wording in report can influence even the postoperative management of the patient. The minimal degree of extrathyroidal growth has no relevance in the recent TNM classification. Unfortunately, this is the degree that we can predict relatively well with ultrasound. The real potential of ultrasound in this field is the exclusion of extrathyroidal extension. We have three ultrasound signs which we can rely on regarding extrathyroidal growth. Only if all three features are detected is there a real risk for gross extrathyroidal spread. We need to be aware that true gross extrathyroidal growth reduces a patient's life expectancy. Only articulate clearly in the ultrasound report when we are 100% sure of it. Note that the positive predictive value for ultrasound is less than 50%, meaning that his or her nodule presents taller than wide sign, no one has yet committed suicide. But this is not true in the event of extrathyroidal extension. Moreover, considering the misinterpretation of the role in TNM classification underlies the importance of the appropriate wording in ultrasound reports. Thank you very much for your attention.